Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
I started in the Atlanta field office in June of 1984. I was the first black female agent ever assigned to that office.
The service meant a lot to me. It hurts me to stand here and to cry in front of national TV. It took me a lot to become what I became and what I am now.
As a little girl, I always wanted to be a Secret Service agent.
I've taught people to become agents, to learn to take the bullet, to learn to stand and fight for your country. But I have to stand here to fight to be respected. And it hurts.
Evidence that ATF and FBI were changing.
Since 1974, when women were first brought into the agency, there has never been a black female manager in the Secret Service. That speaks volumes in that we're good enough to bring us in, we're good enough to protect the president, the vice president, the first lady, and Chelsea Clinton, but we're not good enough to manage people, we're not good enough to give orders to people. That's a problem that I have.
And one of the prerequisites for being a boss at that time.
I've had 16 consecutive years in the Secret Service with 16 consecutive years of outstanding evaluations, but I cannot get promoted. The glass ceiling is firmly intact, firmly in place, and they do not care to move it.
It's just, this is an extremely honorable organization. It's an excellent organization. I left the Marine Corps to come to this organization. So I figured I was going from one high-class operation to another. I'm proud to be a Secret Service agent. But unfortunately, Secret Service is not maintaining its highest ideals and standards.
That's that ATF and FBI were changing their own service at the time, Director McGaw, who later became Director of ATF.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Tuesday, March 12, 2019, so I have been told. Lots of information to report, including Dr. Frances Cress Welsing, her birthday coming up later this month. Sabrina Johnson informed me there's an event that is going to be happening later this month. In her honor, I will give details as we proceed. In addition, again, the COWS 2019 10-year anniversary yoga retreat. We did round one in Virginia successfully, mud and all. Based on the constructive feedback, we're going to see if we can do round two in California, dates July 3rd through July 7th. Just posted on my blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com, with information about the yoga retreat. That is 5 days, 4 nights, Lake Arrowhead, California, which is Southern California, about two hours east, maybe a little less, from Los Angeles. But looking forward to doing yoga, plant-based meals, hanging out exclusively with non-white people, exchanging views on racism, white supremacy, where we can perhaps totally subvert the so-called horror day and just invest constructive time and energy in self-care, counter-racism, and thinking about ways to solve the problem. You can drop an email if you would like additional information, untiljustice@gmail.com. Looking forward to having the event planned and solidified, getting everything together as quickly as we can. So check the blog post for more details. Drop an email if you have questions, and hopefully we will be able to do round two with the CoWS plant-based yoga retreat in California. All of that said, our guest for today's program, we talk about workplace racism on a pretty regular basis. We'll be with our weekly installment, in fact, on workplace racism coming up this Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. So we've been doing workplace racism for years now. One of our listeners wrote in and said, oh, wow, I think there's a book you should check out. Dr. Welsing, again, would say reading is more important than watching television. But hey, you should check out this book. It's got information on workplace racism, and they talk about the 2013 murder of Miriam I. Carey. We've had some of Miss Carey's family members call in to talk about this case and white supremacy racism specifically. For folks who don't remember, this is a black mom. She had her 1-year-old daughter in the backseat of the vehicle, and enforcement officials, you got so many enforcement officials to choose from in D.C. Local enforcement officials, Secret Service, federal enforcement officers. You got piles of them in that area. But dozens of rounds fired at this unarmed black female. They skillful use of words saying that, oh, she rammed the barricade. You know, we got terrorists. They use those car bombs. You know, you never can be too careful. And then it seemed like after that, or even before and after, every other day you had somebody hopping the fence at the White House. None of those folks seemed to be gunned down, shot and killed. They seemed to survive, be taken into custody to figure out what the problem was. But Miriam Carey, black mother, gunned down in the streets of the nation's capital. They said it's even got information on her murder. You all should perhaps have the author as a guest on the program to go into further detail. Reached out. He was willing to speak with us. The book that we plan to discuss, The N-Word is No Secret in the Service, Memoirs of a Black Man in the U.S. Secret Service. You heard the audio clip at the beginning. If you read the book, which is available on Amazon.com, if you read the book, he lists many examples where this is not isolated. Yes, you can read this memoir and get my personal experience of white supremacy racism in the Secret Service, and the word white supremacy is used in the text. But he also lists a number of reports where you can go and do additional research and say, it seems like this is a widespread problem. This is not just one or two or five black people saying that this has been a problem for a day, a month, a year, a decade. This seems to have been a long-running problem of black people being terrorized in the Secret Service, black employees being terrorized in the Secret Service. We'll get to Miriam Carey's terrorism as we proceed. So glad to have him as a guest on the program. We'll get to his time in the Secret Service, his book, and views on white supremacy racism. Joining us live from the program, I think at least one thing that he has in common with our caller in the Thomason, New York, in the New York area, New Jersey, Trenton, New Jersey area. But we'll hear about that as we proceed. Let's see if we can locate our caller, Mr. Muhammad Abdul-Raheem, seeing if I can track down the correct line. You can press star 6-1. That way I can know if I have the correct line as well. That would be helpful. Let's see. Let's see. Do I have Mr. Muhammad's line? Still check in. Might not. Might have difficulties with him being able to dial in. I'll double check to make sure we did not have any interference getting Mr. Muhammad with us. Difficulties. Let's see. Alrighty, that's what I thought. We might have some trouble, so I will give him a jingle on my end. We'll give myself 60 seconds to get Mr. Abdul-Raheem on the line with us. I'll give myself a little audio so that I can dial without being interrupted. 30 seconds, and we will be right back, hopefully, with Mr. Abdul-Raheem, Context of White Supremacy.
Not why he was put in there, or any other black person that they ever give a position to. He's not going to be able, he or she is not going to be able to do any more than the white supremacists let them. See, a lot of black people, on account of they have never taken part in the political process, think that a president is like a king. They don't know anything about what you call going through the legislature or nothing like that. Huge numbers of black people, you know. They think that, you know, once Obama gets in there, all they got to do is just write a letter or get on the cell phone and say, hey, you know, President Barack, yo, you know, I'm down here. I'm out of a job. My name is James Williams. You know. My name is Slim Patterson. Yeah, I've been out of a job for 6 months. My name is Keisha Jordan, you know, can you help me get a college loan, whatnot? Oh, sure, Keisha. Oh, yeah, right. You know, how much you need? There are a lot of black people who think just like that. Sitting in the barbershop saying, you know, man, I voted for that black president, and I look in my mailbox every day. I ain't got a check yet.
All right, we're dialing Mr. Abdul-Raheem now. Hopefully we'll have him on the line and can proceed. Much obliged for your patience.
Hello.
Greetings. Is this Mr. Muhammad Abdul-Raheem?
Speaking, brother. I was just about to call you from another phone, but I guess you see my message. So,
yes, sir. Glad we were able to get everything worked out. Not surprised. Yes. Difficulties here and there, but glad we have you with us on the line. Again, the author of The N-Word is no secret in the service. So glad to have you with us to discuss your text. I'm sure there's some folks, this is their first time hearing about your book. If it's anything that you would like to tell folks about who you are, the work that you do before we get started, if you want to give us a quick introduction, proceed.
Okay, well, my name is Muhammad Abdul-Raheem. I am the author of the book titled The N-Word, It's No Secret in the Service. And I'm originally from Trenton, New Jersey. And basically I wrote the book about my career, my 10-year career in the United States Secret Service. So it's pretty much about, you know, mainly about the systemic racism and my experience with systemic racism in the agency and quite a few other things that I've witnessed and went through in the agency. So that's basically what the book is about. I decided to write the book because I wanted to reach out and I just wanted other people like myself, other African people, African American people, to be able to know that there's somebody that they can relate to, who basically go through the same thing that they go through. And this happens on all levels of employment. And I also wanted the youth. I wanted the youth to be able to read something or have something that they could look at to pretty much prepare them for what they might experience before they go into, you know, careers in corporate America or federal employment or anything as such of that nature.
Right on. Workplace race, we talk about that on a regular basis, having more conversations about workplace racism, the terrorism that we experience on the job, and talking about it so that we can inform other Black people so that they will be prepared and not be blindsided, put it that way, by the same terrorist actions that we experience. For folks who've not seen you or read your book, you're a Black male. Yes, is that accurate?
Yes, I am. I'm a Black African-American male, born in Brooklyn, New York, raised in Trenton, New Jersey.
Right on. Let's see. This broadcast, Context of White Supremacy, I have unfortunately concluded we are in a global system of white supremacy racism. I use those two terms as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. That definition is a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. Yes, I do.
Right on. Always appreciate when we get a succinct yes, and not a whole lot of caveats, and, well, I got to add this and that, just yes, and we can move on to the next question. Before we get, well, I guess it is in the book. It's right in the book. You talk about this at the very beginning. Before we get to your time in the Secret Service, you kind of lay a foundation for your childhood, as you just said, born in New York, but a lot of your formative time in the Trenton, New Jersey area. You talk about your parents not having you in a public school and having you in an African-centered school in your formative years, and the impact that that has had on you and even how you functioned in the Secret Service. Just can you talk about the impact of your academic experience on you as a Black male?
Yeah, so to repeat what you just said, my parents, when I was as a child, my parents, there was a school in Trenton, New Jersey called the African People's Action School. And my parents, they felt that it was best for me and my siblings to attend a school like such where we would, you know, learn about ourselves and about our culture. We wouldn't have the pressure of, you know, celebrating certain holidays that we didn't celebrate and doing other things. So while in the neighborhood, most of my friends went to public school, I went to the school called the African People's Action School. And this is pretty much where I got my culture, besides what my parents taught me, because my mother's an educator as well. Her and my father started a school called Timbuktu Academy, which is the African Center School in Trenton, New Jersey as well. But besides what we were taught and raised, we were raised in school, African People's Action School is where I pretty much got the foundation for knowledge of self and learning about my culture and who I am and who my people are.
That went to sixth grade, so you were not in the public school.
It went to the fifth grade.
Fifth grade.
I'm sorry, it went to the fifth grade. Yeah, so in the sixth grade, I had to attend public school, the same school that my neighborhood friends attended. And that was a major shocker for me right there. That was already... That didn't work too well. It was almost like pretty much taking somebody out of their climate and bringing them to one that wasn't made for them to thrive, you know? So, that was, going to public school was a major shocker for me. Yes.
It was totally different. So you talk about in the school, you all, when you were not in the public school system, learning ostensibly about racism, learning about Marcus Garvey and how this impacted, I think Dr. Welsing might use the term Black self-respect, was instilled in you in this environment. Would that be accurate?
Yes, it would. Yes, definitely. So we were learning about what racism was. We learned about great people from our culture, like you said, Marcus Garvey, Sojourner Truth, Annie Lou Hamer, Harriet Tubman, Malcolm X, and many more. So these are things that we were learning as children. So what that did was basically it instilled a certain amount of pride in us. You know, we were proud of who we were. You know, we were happy that there were, that we were happy to know that there were people like us who did, who ancestors who had contributed majorly to our, you know, enhance our freedom and stuff like that. So it was a great foundation and a good place, a good system to learn under. It was very good for us. And what was the word again that you said, Dr. Francis Cress Wilson said? Because you hit the nail on the head with that one. But
Black self-respect. That's,
yeah, Black self-respect. Perfect. That sounds about perfect right there.
The grandsister, Dr. Welsing, again, her birthday this month. Yes. So yes. You talk about the transition. Unfortunately, this incredible academic environment only lasts to the fifth grade, and then it's to the killing fields. You mm-hmm. talk about this is a horrendous transition from, you know, going to this environment and just feeling like it was worthless and even wanting to leave school at times, just not feeling as though you were in a fertile academic environment. Don't talk about having any dreams as a young child. You sometimes hear children say they want to be a police officer when they grow up. That was not you, unless I read the book wrong. You talk about having a tough childhood growing up in Trenton and seeing the impact of drugs and alcohol. I do want to emphasize, you do talk about drugs, absolutely, but there is equal, if not greater, emphasis on the disruptive impact of alcohol on Black people in the book. Definitely. I think some moron on this program does regularly say, what does he say? He says, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Just the drug aspect is there. I don't want to minimize, but I don't hear as much stress on that alcohol is not cool. What impact did you see alcohol having on Black people in Trenton?
Oh, man, it was made. Well, to backtrack what you said, to go back to what you originally said about me feeling like I just wanted to leave school, I actually did leave school. Like, I quit school in the sixth grade. One day, the year after I got out of African People's Action School, one day I was in school. I remember I was in the sixth grade, and I was just sitting there, and I think I remember clearly they were trying to make us sing some, like, one of those little dumb songs they do in school. And I just got up and left, man. I just went home. I was like, I can't do this no more, man. And, you know, I just walked home. So if it was up to me, I probably wouldn't have went back to school. But, you know, my parents, after that, they put me in another school, which was also a public school. But it was, you know, it was pretty much the same, but it was a little different. It just was a totally different school. I didn't go back to that school anymore. So I actually did leave school in the sixth grade. But, as far as alcohol is concerned, alcohol was a major, I mean, it was a major, major drug in the community. I mean, it destroyed pretty much everything. The thing about alcohol that what I witnessed in Trenton, New Jersey, pretty much everybody who was on any other drug was also an alcoholic, is like their foundation. You know, if somebody smoked crack or whatever was on PCP, they were pretty much an alcoholic also. So I would say alcohol was the number one drug, you know, and it was very accessible. And then again, it was also socially acceptable. I've seen all kinds of, you know, stuff as far as alcohol is concerned. I mean, people just drinking, laying around, being drunk all day. I mean, it got to the point where you would see people and they were drunk 24/7. This was just like their natural being, you know. You get used to it after a while. One thing is, sometimes we would see people, maybe if they were on PCP, they would start acting crazy. You know, if they were on another certain drug, you know, you would see a certain effect. But a lot of people that we've seen on the streets, alcohol was like their, you know, their regular state. I mean, being drunk or being an alcoholic. So alcohol was a horrible drug. I think it was the most detrimental drug in that area, and probably a lot of the areas, urban areas where we are, where people are raised at and where we come from.
Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Mm. Mm. No alcohol at the Cows yoga retreat. So
I don't blame you.
So you managed to escape the dangers and just talking about all the anti-blackness that you witnessed growing up in Trenton, New Jersey, and just a lot of black people not having opportunities, the drugs, the violence, right. the alcohol, and not taking right. care of themselves in a variety of ways. You recognize, mm-hmm. wow, this is not a constructive environment for me. I need to do something better with my life. Mm-hmm. Not that I grew up thinking I want to be a police officer, but hey, right. this yeah. is. And in fact, before I even get to that, you did point out, I thought it was constructive. You found this job searching an obscure website that you had never heard about. Can you just share that with our listeners? Because I thought that was important as well.
Yeah, so my uncle, he lived in the DMV, what we call the DC area. And I guess me and him had a conversation, and I told him I was looking for, you know, for a job or career to get into. And he was familiar with the website USA Jobs. So he told me to look on this website called USA Jobs. I had never heard of it before, didn't know what USA Jobs was. And so I just typed it in and started looking on USA Jobs. I mean, it was the first time for me, but I was shocked that there were so many jobs on this website. I'm like, we never even heard of this. You know, nobody never told us about it. And it just so happened he was in a position where he was around in the atmosphere where he knew about things like this. And so he told me to go on and look, you know. But the website, it was a shocker for me. I was like, I didn't even know this existed.
I'll try and point out that pattern. Dr. Kamal Kamban, a repeated guest on the COWS over the years, COWS decade, mm-hmm. He has said that the reason they use the term disadvantaged when they're not calling us niggers is because we are missing information. And he says that one of the major ways that whites practice racism is withholding constructive information. And I would say that is boop, one right there. Now, we're going to talk about this will be a major pattern. We'll talk about this again in the program, withholding mm-hmm. constructive information, because that happens all that. That's why you have to be great at asking questions when you're in an environment right. where people are deliberately trying to withhold constructive info. So before we get to Secret mm-hmm. Service, workplace racism pops up. So it takes a long time. You talk about that. I think it was like 2 years for you to actually go through the hiring process with all the polygraphs and background checks and urine samples right. and all this stuff. It's not a quick thing to get this job. So you're doing other jobs in yeah. the meantime while you're waiting mm-hmm. for all of this to play out. So you talk about working
right.
At this company, Wyeth, I guess, W-Y-E-T-H. Is that how you say it? Wyeth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, that's how it's pronounced. Yeah.
Okay. You talk about some of the racism that you experience at this company, Wyeth. I'll read a little bit from the book and get your response. Mm-hmm. And I chuckled so much because we have had many incidents like this pop up on workplace racism, which is every Friday, 8 right. p.m. Eastern to 5 right. p.m. Pacific. In fact, we had this pop up because this is about to be about Black History Month, which we just passed, Carter G. Woodson.
Right.
But we had Stacey in the UK. Now, they have Black History Month in October. They had the same mm-hmm. trifling antics pop up over there in October for Black History Month, which is in October. But you're right. So this is at Wyeth.
Yeah.
With all the great Black... Let me back up one more paragraph. Okay. Here's a very interesting scenario that I had to deal with as a young employee at Wyeth. This takes place during Black History Month in February. Wyeth was a company that tried to recognize different ethnic groups during their holiday. I felt that this was a good thing that the company did for people of various ethnic groups. Since Wyeth was a research company, I figured that it would only be right to recognize great Black people in science for Black History Month. Recognizing Black culture in science made sense to me, but obviously it didn't quite to a few other people. With all the great Black scientists and researchers in American history, such as George Washington Carver, Ernest Everett, Emmett Chappelle, and Charles Drew, I knew that this would be an easy project. I see what the company did to recognize other ethnic groups. Other ethnicities made major contributions to America, but no other group contributed more to the infrastructure and development of America than my people, who are African Americans. At the beginning of Black History Month, I proceeded to the cafeteria one day, and what I saw shocked the hell out of me. To commemorate Black History Month, Wyatt decided to have fried chicken and cornbread on the menu in the cafeteria. I can't make this up. Yes. I'm laughing right now as I write this because I recently saw stories in the media about these things happening at public schools and other places. We've heard about this on the cows repeatedly, this exact type of thing for Black History Month. How did you handle this situation then? And then the follow-up would be 2019, how would you handle this situation now?
Okay, so at the time, I was pretty shocked. You know, like I said, I think I was probably the youngest African American employee at the time who worked there, and it was real shocking to me. And I'm like, hold up, are they serious? And so I figured that I could just go to, you know, the head boss, who was a Caucasian man in the operations division. I can go to him and just say, hey, listen, man, I was offended, you know, by this, you know, fried chicken and cornbread. I mean, biscuits or cornbread, whatever was in the cafeteria. And so I went to his office. I walked down there. I went to his office. I said that, and knocked on the door. I spoke to him. I said, hey, listen, he said, hey, what's going on? So I sat down. I said, well, I was offended. I'm offended by, you know, why is having, you know, fried chicken and cornbread for Black History Month with all the other things that they could have did. I don't see how this was something that the company would come up with when I've seen numerous other, you know, other things that the company has done for other cultures. Why do we have, you know, fried chicken and cornbread for Black History Month? And he said, well, I talked to the other Black people and they said they were okay with it. And I was upset. That just blew me. And I was like, well, I'm not okay with that. I'm not okay with that at all. And when he initially, when he told me that, I was kind of mad at first. I was a little embarrassed, you know? And then I thought, man, at first I was initially upset with my African-American co-workers, but I always liked them. You know, I always liked them a lot. So, like I said in the book, I think I might have, you know, threw some shade at them for probably a week or two, probably 2 weeks at the most. But again, they were nice people. I liked them. They were my people. So it didn't last long. You know, I just stopped speaking to them for maybe a week or two, probably 2 weeks, I think, at the most. And everything went back to normal. I was kind of crushed by that. You know, it was embarrassing also. In 2019, if that would have happened now, I would do a little bit more. I would have definitely addressed the culprit or anybody who thought that was okay, the department or the manager or anybody who thought that was okay to do something like that. But then I would have definitely called. I would definitely call my people, and we would have to have a private conversation, and then I would demand that we all go back and take care of this and get this taken away, or demand an apology or something like that. So now I wouldn't have just, you know, it was kind of, I guess my response was a little, you know, immature at the time, because I spoke to a couple of them, but, you know, again, a lot of these people were like my parents' age. So I didn't feel like I was in a position to, you know, pull them and school them and give them some knowledge on what's going on, or telling them what we need to do, because I also had that, you know, that respect factor for them as well. But now, if that would have happened, I would go about it a little different. I would definitely address it to the people who were responsible for doing this, and also for the people who, my people, who, you know, thought it was okay to do. So,
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Mr. Muhammad Abdul-Raheem. One of the suggestions Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. gives out regularly, VGQ, Victims Guaranteed Qualified, that is exactly that type of scenario when you have a suspected race soldier and they say, oh, well, you know, I talked to all the other niggers, I mean African-Americans, and they said they thought it was great. They thought, you know, fried chicken and cornbread, that's the best thing ever. Well, that's fine. Mm-hmm. They can take, you know, whatever perspective that they have. My view, you know, and then you just go back with whatever perspective that you have. Is this what, and always advocating the question lane, do you think this is the best way to represent Black employees at Wyeth is with fried chicken and cornbread? Mm-hmm. That's what we want to associate black workers, the black workers who are trying to make Wyatt the best company we can be, we want them associated with cornbread and fried chicken. Is that what we're saying? Or whatever other questions. But yeah, BGQ, great one. They always do that on a regular basis.
Yeah, it's true.
With, I reckon, to make sure we cover as much as we can with the Secret Service, you go through, they have numerous polygraph exams that you have to go through. They do background checks where they come and talk to folks, go to all the addresses where you've lived before and go and hang out and talk to people that you grew up with in Trenton, New Jersey. You finally get through all of this, and then you have to go through the training process. Give us the demographics of your training group. Like, how many whites are in the training group? How many black people?
Okay, so in my training group, out of 24, there were five black people. One of them, one black person, they dropped out though. Around maybe the first week, I remember him just disappearing. I don't know what happened. I don't know if it was for health reasons or what. So basically, we had four black people out of a class of out of the class of 24. We had four black people. Actually, yeah, we had four black people out of the class of 24. There was a class that was about 2 weeks before us, and what we often call them our sister classes. They had one black person out of about 20 something. So, you know, between the two classes, there was about five, there was a total of five black people and at least 40 Caucasians.
Wow.
Over 40 Caucasians, sorry, but maybe about 45 Caucasians and five black people between the two classes. So, you know, it was very, I kind of expected that though. I didn't expect to see too many of my people there because that's just, you know, in these fields, in these type of jobs, that's just how it is. But yeah, that's how it was. As far as instructors are concerned, we didn't see black instructors. Nothing but Caucasian men, some Caucasian women, but we didn't see black instructors at all.
You you talk about some of the instructors as being specifically racist and some of the different things that they did during the training process. But I want to make sure before we bid Wyeth adieu, you do talk about in this process, as I said, they had to go and they go talk to some of the folks at Wyeth, you know, what's up with this guy? Give us some background information. And you talk about a key decision that you made in this process was to not alert your coworkers at Wyeth that, oh, hey, I'm going through Secret Service clearance. You know, some folks might come by and have some questions. You didn't tell them in advance, and you feel like this ended up working out well for you and giving us another illustration of white supremacy racism. Can you share?
Yeah, so at the time, I figured that it didn't really make sense for me to alert, you know, my human resources department or my coworkers, my supervisors, that I was going through the background process with the U.S. Secret Service, because I felt that telling them would only give them time to think about petty things and, you know, and maybe possibly come up with some things to say or, you know, try to do something to sabotage, you know, my background investigation. I felt that it was best that if I didn't forewarn them and they were just asked on the spot, they would have to say the first thing that comes to their mind, or they would also have to show documents as far as performance reviews or whatever, without, you know, without having time to think. I felt that idle time would give them time to think about, you know, different ways to be, you know, devious or possibly say things that could sabotage the background investigation. So I didn't tell them at all, which was good, because I knew that, you know, they can only say good things anyway, because that's what kind of employee I was. But what was crazy was at the time that they came in, I had a supervisor who, when they went to speak to him, he did tell them, you know, that I was a good employee and everything. But they asked him to speak to three of my coworkers. They said, okay, well, we need to speak to three of his coworkers. Now, what he did was he picked three coworkers who I wasn't, you know, they were okay with me, but I wasn't friendly with them. And one of them, me and him had a little argument one day. It wasn't an argument that, you know, went anywhere past the room, but we had an argument, you know, voices were raised a little bit, but it ended right there. So basically, this guy, I think he went and told them. Yeah, he went and told them to try to play the scared thing. You know how a lot of white supremacists do that as well, you know. But he went and told this supervisor, and after that, nothing happened, okay, because it was no big deal. But this supervisor picked him and two of his friends to speak on my character to this U.S. Secret Service background investigator. Out of all the people that he could have picked, you know, it seemed almost like, well, no, it didn't seem. He was basically trying to, you know, set me up a little something by picking these people who he knew they didn't give a bad review, but he could have, there were a lot of other people that he could have picked. Even if he wanted to pick white people, he could have picked a couple white people that he knew I was friendly with, you know. He didn't pick any African Americans. He didn't pick, you know, anybody that he knew that I was definitely okay with. He picked three people that he probably thought would possibly get some adverse information or do the job that he wanted to do, you know.
Context of White Supremacy, again, Workplace Racism, is every Friday. Mm-hmm. I thought that was a spectacular one. Just you really have to do some thinking, like with workplace. That is not an environment where you want to be emotional and just, you know, not really using logic as you go about your decisions. Mm-hmm. You want to be methodical and say, wait a minute, if I give them more time, they could just sit around and think, hey, I do not want to see this nigga get a Secret Service job. Let me think. Oh, right. Yeah. He was late 5 years ago. I think he spilled coffee on the desk about 3 years ago. I think, yeah, I'll remember that one. Or we might even make up a few stories. Let me call Bill. Bill, help me make up some story. We can't let this. I mean, you never know what you're dealing with. I'm not going to give them all that time. You're going to have 30 seconds. Somebody's going to ask you right now, and you just got to respond. I'm going to give you less time to practice racism. Brilliant.
Exactly. Exactly, and that's exactly what I was thinking. And I had a supervisor who worked under the one who picked these three people to do this, and he was pretty upset. Well, he was an African American supervisor. He was pretty upset. He called me. He said, "Hey, Muhammad, let me talk to you." He said, "There's some hating going on," and he said, "You know that he picked them." He said, "Do you know he also told them about that dumb argument you had?" This dude named Jerry was his name. He said, he told them about that dumb argument that you had with Jerry that day. He said, he didn't have to do that. I was like, yeah, I know. But, yep. And that's exactly why I didn't want to give them, see, even with the way I did it, without giving them, you know, time to prepare, they still tried something, you know?
That is the system of white supremacy racism. No surprises, unfortunately. No surprises. So thankfully, this does not sabotage your effort. You are able to get through all of this, and we move on to training with the Secret Service. And you talk about a variety of racist instructors. You talk about one specifically who was intimidated by black men and tried whatever he could to disqualify them. Specifically, did you see where you thought, wow, this guy is, that was your conclusion, this guy's intimidated by black males and he's trying to get rid of them, get rid of us any way he can?
Well, that was quite a few of them. Ooh, that was quite a few of them. So in training the way it works is basically you have a group of you know, instructors, technicians, they're called trainers and people as such, who are responsible for preparing us for our careers in the U.S. Secret Service. The thing about it is, these guys, they carry, you know, their sickness, the sickness in their hearts into their training. So they can't really educate us or train us unbiasedly without that, you know, sickness that they have affecting what they do. So I was the type that always, you know, paid attention to what was going on. I would notice that these instructors, they would keep an eye on us more than they would keep an eye on other classmates or other people, Caucasian classmates. And the littlest thing that we did, they would always spot it and find it out. They would spot it, speak on it, and say, you know, come up with some reason or this, this, and that, and hey, you're doing this wrong, doing that wrong. And, you know, I would sit back and watch other people do things the same exact way, and nothing would be said. You know, I would sit back and watch guys do all kinds of different drills. I would watch people, they would be, this word, commended for certain things that they did in certain scenarios and drills, whereas a black person might do the same thing and there was something wrong with it. It was clear that these guys couldn't train us unbiased without letting the sickness, the racist sickness in their hearts affect what they did with us. It was very obvious. And in addition, I also noticed that black people were booted out of training and disqualified at a much, much faster, without as many chances as the other guys had. I've seen it happen in my class, and it happened in numerous other classes. And like I said in the book, we often had to exceed the requirements where a lot of our Caucasian counterparts didn't even meet the requirements, and they continued to go. Like, I had a guy in my class who was kicked out 4 times, and they kept giving him chances. I mean, class after class after class, kept on letting him go. Clearly, he was messed up. He just wasn't physically and mentally able. But I also had a classmate who didn't qualify on the test, a black classmate, and he was going immediately, bam, quit. But the same guy had 4 chances, and he still didn't make it. He still didn't make it. So the bias in training was just very evident. It was clearly, you could clearly see it. And again, if you have a white supremacist, if you hire a white supremacist to be a trainer, whether it be a firearms instructor, a controlled tactics instructor, or a classroom instructor, that's going to reflect in their work performance. They can't keep that in. They can't hold that in. And all one had to do was sit back and watch and pay attention. And it was so obvious.
You said, in your training, they were not talking about radicalized white identity extremists who were committing acts of terrorism. Not talking about those groups who've been proliferating over the last 15, 20 years or so. They spent a lot more time talking about non-white terrorists, all different colors, using that word intentionally. And you said, I guess this type of training was effective because once I started my tour at the White House, most of the patrol units in the U.S. Secret Service profiled black, brown, and people of Arab descent. He also would tell other students in the class that they can ask me, talking about you, about things concerning Islamic extremism. I clearly knew what he was doing. I would sit in his class thinking, damn, this weasel keeps his racist rhetoric going and using me as an example. I want to say something. Right. But I need this job, and I can't ruffle any feathers. I think that is also counter-racist logic. Do you want to give a little more detail?
Right. So I had we had an instructor down in Georgia at the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center, and his block of class was on terrorism. Some guy, I forget the exact name of the class, but it was on terrorism, and he would go on and on and on all class. I mean, he would show videos. He even showed a rap video of some terrorists rapping about, you know, whatever, blowing stuff, I don't know, Al-Qaeda or something like that. And this dude would go on and on and on talking about what they do in Israel and Israeli measures and what they do. They bury the terrorists in pig skin. And this dude was just going on. I mean, every day he would go on and on and on. And he was just so, I could tell he was just in love with Israeli security measures. I mean, he just wouldn't stop. And it was like, he would say things like, after he said something, he would say, you can ask Abdul-Raheem over there. He'll tell you. And, you know, I'm already feeling like, man, I don't like this dude. You know what I mean? Because he kept going on and on. And eventually one day I had to say something to him, you know, because then he started lying. And I waited till the class left. As I was walking out the room, then I turned back and I went back to him and I said, hey, listen, man, you said, I forget his name. I didn't call him man. And he said, I said, you said, something about, basically he lied about a verse in the Quran. And I said to him, I said, that wasn't in the Quran. Where'd you get that from? I said, that's not true. And then he said, oh, no, that's not, That's how they twist it to say that. That's not in there, but that's how they twist it. I said, but that's not what you said. You said it was in there. Then he said, yeah, but what I really meant. I said, okay. And I just walked out. And I was just thinking, dang, I better get 100. I better get 150 out of 100 on this test. Because I know he's going to fail me the first opportunity he get, man. You know? But, you know, that's how it was. This guy, he was definitely pushing that. And I think the rhetoric, things that he was saying in class, I guess pretty much everybody went through that. And it was pretty obvious because a lot of these guys, man, they already come out the box, you know, white supremacists, race soldiers. So not saying that they needed him. Some of the guys needed him to, encourage them or give them confirmation because a lot of them were already like that. Not speaking of the guys who I went through with, because a lot of the guys in my the classmates that I had, they weren't like they didn't go out there and do this. They pretty much didn't go out there and do this and become these, you know, racial profilers, race soldiers around the White House. But most of the other guys who did that, who were out there, they all pretty much were. So I would imagine that they all went through. Well, they had to go through the same kind of training. You know, they already come out the box like that in the first place with this issue with racism and stuff like that and how they view black people. And then, you know, you have a class like this, and this is like, you know, encouraging them and just giving them more room to get even more scared, you know, and things to look out for and this and that. And it was horrible, you know. It shows, and it showed in the work performance once we went fully operational as well.
Context of White Supremacy. You go into detail talking about how this would happen regularly in the training. You all would have to do marksmanship. You all would go out for firearms training. And the white instructor would say, oh, no, you're doing it wrong. Talking to the black recruit, you'd go over. The black recruit would go over and talk to the white person and say, oh, no. Just do it like this. He said, that's the exact way I've been doing it. So, well, just go to Technician Williams. He'll do it. He's always correct with how he just. He says, that's who I just talked to. And I say, I don't understand. And you go on to say that a Caucasian or detached African-American person will witness a scenario like this and not understand what is going on. And you talk about how this happens every day and trying to go to return something at the store. And you tell a white person and they're like, oh, I return things all the time. And the black person tries to do it. They're like, oh, no, we don't take those items. And you say many Caucasian people won't understand this because they didn't go a lifetime having to deal with these types of scenarios. Also, Caucasians who are genuinely good people don't understand that every white person isn't like them. Some of them think that they have to literally hear the word nigger for there to be racism present. I read this and I said, wow, how did Mr. Abdul-Raheem come to this conclusion?
Right. So how did I come to that conclusion?
Yes, sir. That many white people won't understand. Mm-hmm. It sounds racism, white supremacy, because that was what was being explained. Black people being mistreated, racism being practiced against black people. So how did you come to conclude that many Caucasian people won't understand this being racism ostensibly? How did you come to understand that many Caucasian people, whites, won't understand this racism?
Well, just as many do understand it as they don't, but many of them. So I think we live in a world where a lot of white people think that racism is just being called a nigger. They don't understand all the other things that we go through when people treat us like a nigger, you know? So they pretty much, a lot of them pretty much have to hear this. They have to hear a white supremacist say, hey, this guy's nigger. And a lot of them even treat us like a nigger and not even know it, because that's just the way it is. You know, that's the way it's always been. So a lot of things may happen where we know we're being treated wrong. We feel uncomfortable and something doesn't feel right. They can't relate to it. They didn't see anybody being called a nigger. They didn't see a Klan cone head or nothing like that. So they don't understand what kind of racism is going on, because it's different level. They don't understand. What I'm trying to say is They don't understand the covert racism.
Okay, I guess my question is, how did you come to that conclusion? Like, what evidence or what process did you go through where you concluded that many white people don't understand this, whether it's the covert aspects or some of the other nuanced ways that white supremacy is practiced? How did you arrive at that conclusion?
Oh, just from hearing people talk and explaining things to people, to white people. So for instance, like as far as the situation goes with the scenario that I gave, let's say it's two of them that I spoke about. Let's say a control tactics drill, where a white person may have done something, you know, they may have done something, and then with this same subject who's grading both of us, the African, the black subject and the white subject, the black person might say, hey, this guy's flunking me, he's failing me. You go to the white person and he says, hey, don't worry about it. Go to this person, or go to this other guy. Go to this other guy right here, and this same guy is the one who's, you know, treating them bad, or this is the same guy is the one who keeps saying that this guy's selling them. You know, so I've come to the conclusion that a lot of white people don't understand what's going on, which would be a form of covert racism. They don't understand what's going on because we just have different emotions. We're used to this. We've been feeling this our whole lives. Simple things as far as being pulled over by the police, returning something from a store, walking down the street, having your hands in your pockets, things like that. These are little things that we have to watch, you know, and we've known that our whole lives. Most white people don't understand that because they just don't live in our shoes. So some of the little things that we automatically do in order just to stay alive or not go to, you know, be arrested or go to prison, they wouldn't understand that because they didn't have to live that. And I mean, these are examples that I've seen. All of us, we've seen these things pretty much our whole, as long as we've been around white people, from the time that we've been around white people to whenever we've seen, I've seen this pretty much all the time. And I think that's just that's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. That's just the culture of the country, you know?
Context of white supremacy. One of the things I say on the broadcast regularly, white people are not ignorant about white supremacy, racism. That's one of the things that I've come to a firm conclusion about. And I think that any white person, if they're classified as white, I think it is logical to conclude that they are not ignorant about any of the aspects of white supremacy, racism. It's their mothers and fathers and sons and daughters and sisters and brothers and grandpas and grandmothers and aunts and uncles for generations, centuries, that have been practicing the racism, if not themselves directly. They would have to be ignorant about their family and friends to be ignorant about all the different ways that racism is practiced. I've just concluded that white people are very, in fact, that the thing that I say in those type of scenarios when white people are seeming like they don't understand these things because they haven't experienced them is that they could just be lying. I have concluded that frequently that's one of the major ways that white people practice racism is by pretending to be ignorant about racism so that the black person can talk and talk and talk and talk and talk for years sometimes. And maybe they'll say they got it one day, maybe they don't, and we're still on the plantation. But you had, I could be in error. You had a great scenario.
No, I understand. Mm-hmm.
You had a great scenario. I want to read a little bit from the book and get your response. That is about codification in the workplace. Emmy, who is in the DMV area, DC, Maryland, Virginia, where she talks about body language. She brings this up on mm-hmm. workplace racism on a regular basis and saying, you know, you can be codified with what you say and having a word diet, as you say, and that can be totally irrelevant if your body language gives it away with, you know, what you are thinking of what you're saying. So you have to be on a body language diet as well in terms of being mindful about how you're positioning yourself, your facial gestures and such. So you have a section in the text. This is in chapter 13. You're talking about understanding the mentality of some of these racist bullies that you had on the job. And you said, I knew that it was very important for me to let this one particular racist guy know from jump that I wasn't one of those guys who could be pushed around. I never cared what someone's title was. I treated everyone with respect until they showed me that they were not worthy of it. Around the time that Official Sinclair and the deputy chief walked near my area at the North Portico, I was at wit's end with the white supremacist United States Secret Service officials walking around bullying people. Turning the page, I stood there thinking, go ahead and say something stupid, monkey, so I can introduce myself. Nothing happened. He remained quiet, and so did I. The body language and eyes were enough for him to understand what kind of time I was on. And I'm stopping there because you go in depth talking about having a ritual, a code that you went through on a daily basis to preserve your sanity. And I thought, again, this is brilliant. This is the exact sort of thing that I would want on workplace racism, that I would want every single CO.W.S listener, every single codified non-white person. This is what we should all have when we go to work. Like, can you explain, because this was a part of it, having your body language down, what you say, what you don't say, the word diet, as you explain. Can you kind of give us some in-depth detail about what your daily ritual, including, because prayer was a part of it, your Muslim faith, you talk about that in the book. Can you kind of give a detailed explanation of what you did to preserve your sanity?
Okay, so in order to preserve my sanity, one thing I had to do was in the morning, you know, I had to make my morning prayer, which is Fajr prayer. And it's called Fajr prayer. And after that, I had to go to the gym. I had to work out. And the workout high would really help me out. You know, it would push me pretty deep in the day, you know, as long as I worked out. You know, I would be pretty much high off of my workout. I made sure that I avoided, you know, places where my coworkers would congregate and sit around. I didn't want to take the chance of hearing, you know, a white supremacist say something that they seen on TV. Because these guys, they would do things like they would sit in these break rooms and just turn TV shows on that I just didn't want them to watch, you know. And what they would often do, like it could be a show like, let's say, I don't know, a movie might come on. Let's say a derogatory movie, Soul Plane. Let's say Soul Plane comes on. So just imagine, you know, a black man, you're sitting in a room, maybe it's two black men with 6-7 white people, and Soul Plane comes on and they just loving it, you know. Eventually they're going to start, you know, making little comments and, you know, snapping their heads in their hands. A lot of times the guys would do that, you know, trying to emulate black women, trying to be funny. I didn't want to take the chance of being around some people who would possibly start telling a nigga joke that they used to getting away with one of our other people. And if they said it around me, now I'm in the middle of it and I have to do something. I also didn't want to take a chance of seeing them bullying one of our people where I might have to say something. So what I would do is I would just avoid them altogether. I felt like that by that time, I felt that these people were my enemy anyway. You know, I didn't like being around them. So I would just go places where none of them were at. I might go into a local store and you know, sit there and where none of my coworkers were at. I never felt comfortable, after a while, I didn't feel comfortable around them at all, you know. So that was enough. That was one thing that I had to do. Besides working out in the morning, avoiding my coworkers at all costs, staying away from them, not being involved in superficial conversations. And, you know, if I did have an assignment where they were going to be at in groups, I would just try to, you know, trade off with somebody where I would just go somewhere isolated, where I just wouldn't have to see them, or probably just work with somebody who I was cool working with. And my whole thing was isolation. Just stay away from them. The less time that I had to see these people, talk to them, hear their voices, the better off I was. My day always went a lot better. I had to turn off the radio. You know, I had to turn off the radio. We have radios that we carry where you could hear the transmissions going on over the air. Now, I had to turn my radio off because we would constantly hear, you know, our people being pulled over and profiled and harassed in the White House area. You know, one black male, one black female, two black males, two black females. After you hear this for hours and hours throughout the day, throughout the week, throughout the month and year, it starts to do something to you because you know these guys right here are the same guys that carry the same weapon as you. And it's like, now how are you looking at them, knowing that they're harassing your people, you know? So that's a rough spot for somebody like me to be in. Because now my thing was, now you're the enemy now. You know, now I'm in here with you, you're the enemy. I got to watch you. And I really did, you know. That's just the way I was wired, you know. I never felt comfortable around them. All the way down to weapons. I would keep my weapon in a certain position. When we were in small places like locker rooms, changing, especially if I was around, you know, somebody who I thought was kind of mentally unstable, which we, quite a few of them are, I made sure that I, you know, I was okay, that I could grab something and reach it as quick as possible. But I didn't like being around them in the first place, you know, so that's what I had to do to keep my family pretty much going into isolation and stay away from them as much as possible.
Context of White Supremacy. Wow. if you have not seen the movie Soul Plane, don't. I am not encouraging anyone to view the film. Maybe you could watch the trailer. That's maybe, if you can find a trailer that is 60 seconds or less, watch the trailer and then just, you know, replay what you heard from Mr. Abdul-Raheem about this. These are the people that are in charge of protecting the vice president, the president, keeping order at the White House and other facilities. They travel and protect, you know, powerful people. That's what they tell us. These people have firearms. When we get to Miriam Carey, imagine these whites sitting and watching Soul Plane. And or other, because it seemed like this wasn't like a one-time thing, like whatever other, I think you said like the Real Housewives and I guess Friday.
Yeah, like, you know, I would just get upset, you know, when Stephen A., you know, like a lot of times guys would watch sports stations and, you know, Stephen A., and you're sitting in a room with maybe a group of, you know, guys, you know, a couple of them that you know have been or have a reputation for treating our people, you know, bad, you know, white supremacist guys. And then Stephen A. Smith just comes on TV, you know, talking about us, validating their sick mindsets, you know. That stuff, I couldn't take it, you know. These are the situations and the scenarios that you could be in.
What about people who say, hey, that's I don't like that strategy of saying that you're not going to hang out, you're not going to do the social functions when it's almost holiday season or summertime is coming up. They might have picnics, company picnics and that sort of thing, holiday parties or luncheons, you know, to go out to say that you're not going to do that at all. Like, oh, man, that's career suicide. You got to do that. You got to have some camaraderie. What do you say to that?
Well, for me, I already accepted what I was, that I wasn't, I didn't want, I didn't, I was willing to risk that to, you know, not participate in these extracurricular activities. If I wasn't getting paid for it, I wasn't coming. And I would tell people, I don't even, you know, I don't even want to talk to you when I'm getting paid for it. What makes you think I want to come around and be around you and I'm not getting paid for it, you know? So for me, it was a no brainer. But for somebody else, I would say, think about it, because you might do all of these things. You might go to this party, you might go here, you might smile here, you might participate and have this camaraderie, and you still, and these are the people who did this are often abused even more, though. For us, it doesn't work like that. It's only a couple positions, you know, for us. So I haven't seen it work out. The percentages for success with that right there, with that strategy, as far as the camaraderie and participating in the extracurricular activities, it usually doesn't work in our favor. It often doesn't help your career. It doesn't, put you to a different place. For some people, it does. For some people it does, but for most of us it doesn't. And it's pretty evident. I mean,
Context of White Supremacy, the book we are discussing, The N-Word is No Secret in the Service. Also, in your code for the workplace, you talked, because I thought this was important, Mr. Fuller talked about the same thing. And you said that you would get to work early, you would get up, you would do your prayer, you would go to the gym, and someone who gets up for morning yoga, I certainly appreciated that. Get up, go to the gym, and then you would go to work early, which was huge because that meant you got better parking. If you're in an area where you have really bad parking, that can mean the difference between you having to catch a shuttle and it being a really long commute, so to speak, from where you parked to getting to your job site, as opposed to you got great parking and you can go with your day. Just being able to get up and be there early. Huge part of the code for black people, especially if they're going to use all that discretion. And, oh, you were 17 seconds late. Going to put that one down. Oof, that might be the difference in that promotion. When you're looking for a special assignment or pay. Yeah, I think you were about 10 seconds late about 5 years ago. That's, man, if you had only been 18 seconds earlier, we would have. So I love that one about being early. You definitely. Also, can you speak to, and if folks have questions, the number 641-715-3640, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Can you speak to the ways that you saw social media being used to spy on black employees?
Well, what happened is, some of the black employees that work, you know, in the agency, they didn't understand that everybody didn't have their best interests at heart. So sometimes some of them thought that people at work were their friends. They really thought that since these guys, you know, they sit around and talk to these guys and have sports talk and giggle and laugh, some of them would think that they can invite these people into their personal lives. So what they would do is invite them on their social media, which is the biggest no-no. I would always encourage anybody, never bring your coworkers into your social media, especially your Caucasian coworkers who don't have your best interests at heart. So what they would do is they would invite these guys into social media thinking that, oh, we're all friends. And the littlest things that they did, these people would watch their social media and they would go back and they would relay it to high-ranking officials. I mean, they would go back in some kind of way. Of course, they had a pipeline, and somebody they thought was their buddy would go back to a high-ranking official and say, hey, listen, whatever, this person did this, this person did that. One guy got in trouble. They were spying on his social media, and they went back and said that he was wearing unauthorized gear. He was taking pictures in agency gear on his social media. And he got in trouble for that. When there were so many guys who, you know, there were so many guys who were proud of their agency gear and they were taking pictures on social media here and there with gear, but they wanted to pick on him and accuse him of, I don't know what it may be called, what the transgression is actually called, but they were saying that he was wearing gear on social media with, I guess, U.S. Secret Service, emblems that he shouldn't have had on the social media, which is and he got in trouble for it. But that comes from, you know, inviting coworkers on social media who are doing nothing but sitting back spying and looking at pictures and going back and gossiping and telling high-ranking officials who can get you in trouble, high-ranking white supremacist officials who would do anything to get these people in trouble. So that's a big no-no, and that's another issue. That's some of the things that our people would do is, you know, invite these people on our social media. People who are not our real friends. I mean, we don't live in the same neighborhoods. They have children. Their children never go to the same school. The most they would have is sports buddy talk, and that's it. And these guys would be their friends. I didn't understand it, but it was a no-no for me.
That is a big no-no on workplace racism. Fridays, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Dr. Kanban, again, he recommended that a long time ago. He said not having a social media account at all in case they are really nosy racists on your job, who even though you have not friended them, they will still snoop and see if they can find your page and see what you're writing or posting and that sort of thing. But really be mindful about that sort of thing, because as you stated, many of the folks that we are spending 40 hours of our lives with while we're on these jobs, they do not have our best interest at hand. Some of the folks who dialed in with questions, the number again, 641-715-6340, the code 564-943-POUND. I'm trying to give out the number correctly. 641-715-3640, the code 564-943-POUND. Press *61 if you have a question. Think a fellow New Jersey resident or someone at least with ties. Thomas in New York now. Did you have commentary for Mr. Abdul-Raheem?
Good evening, Gus. Good evening, Mr. Raheem.
Good evening.
Yeah, I do have ties to New Jersey, but a whole other section. I'm from Jersey City. Yeah, it's still New Jersey, you know, piece of trade. Right. I got family down there. I have two questions. I watched, big up to MHDC, he sent me some videos of you with some prior interviews you did. So it's two questions I specifically want to ask.
Thank
the first one is, can you explain white female privilege?
Okay. White female privilege was pretty much that I experienced, that I witnessed in the U.S. Secret Service. It was the immunity that white women enjoyed. So pretty much these women, a lot of the culture of the agency was white women would commit some of the most, we're talking illegal, unethical transgressions, and we would never see them get into any trouble. And oftentimes this was because of something that they might know from the past, whether it be sexual relationships with higher ranking officials that they can possibly expose or talk about, or the fact that some of these higher ranking guys might want to have relations or have some kind of relationship with these Caucasian women. Also, they were often promoted at the most rapid pace without training. So I remember in the agency, you would have women who didn't have experience. I mean, Caucasian women who didn't have experience doing much of anything except filing papers. And these women would be teaching people how to fire, you know, weapons and, you know, semi-automatic and automatic weapons just because they got what they wanted. They were often also promoted at a rapid pace with no experience whatsoever. None. I mean, they weren't leaders. The most, see, some of them, what often went on is these women would enjoy certain positions like clerk positions, and they would be in these positions, which these positions would, it would keep them from any conflict or the chances of them doing things where they might make a mistake or even get in trouble or get hurt or anything. So while they were in these positions, they were still considered fully operational. And what they would do is they would take promotional exams and they would just move up the ranks with no type of training whatsoever, no people skills, social skills, tactical skills. It didn't matter. Caucasian women often were promoted and moved up the ranks and offered technician positions where they didn't have any training at all, whereas African American or black women weren't getting anything at all. And if you were African American man, you pretty much had everything lined up and squared away just to get, you know, anything. And these women were being promoted at rapid paces. They were given positions which they weren't qualified for, and they never got in trouble. I mean, I don't ever remember seeing a Caucasian woman having their security clearance suspended or snatched or whatever. That never happened. The most that ever happened that I've seen was if they did commit illegal transgressions, unethical transgressions as well, they would just be relocated or put somewhere into another position. But as far as getting in trouble, they never got in trouble. I don't think anybody could ever say that they know of a Caucasian woman who actually faced real disciplinary action for either illegal or an unethical transgression within the agency. And they did it all the time, trust me. I mean, we're talking about all the way to, you know, performing sex acts at work that these people knew about, that they were caught doing, and they never got in trouble for these type of things.
Wow. Interesting. My second question, before I go there, did you ever witness one of the few black cadets or anything having intercourse or relations with these white women?
Have I ever seen it myself or heard about it happening work?
Exactly. Like, was that ever an instance where one of your black coworkers was dating?
Of course. Oh, that's law enforcement. That's the norm, right? That, in law enforcement, that's what it is, man. You know, that's very common. That's more common than uncommon. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir. My second question, and once again, this is based off of another interview I saw, and it was so shocking because on this show, we did a lot of talking about the breaches in security when President Obama was the president, and you were one of his Secret Service details. And you told a story about a rifle shot that went through the White House window, and Michelle Obama found the glass, and they did not want to explain to her what happened. Can you explain that to us, please?
Right. So this story could be Googled and referenced as well. The name of the guy who did this is in the book. So there was a guy on Constitution Avenue, some nutcase, his goal, he wanted to kill the president. He wanted to kill President Barack Obama. He had spoke of this previously to his family in the past. So this guy one day is on Constitution Avenue with a high power rifle. I don't know if you've ever been to the D.C. area where the White House is, where, you know, Constitution Avenue to the White House. That's a nice little, you know, long range shot. Not that far. It's not a sniper shot, but it's a pretty long range shot. This guy was on Constitution Avenue and he was shooting rounds from Constitution Avenue over the Truman balcony. The rounds were hitting the window. It was hitting the cement, the window. So basically, there was a official who was, you know, the manager that night. He was the official. There were guys who weren't that far from this guy who was shooting this rifle. They didn't see him shooting at the time, but they can hear it. They were looking around. They could hear it, and they could even smell it. There's a certain smell that you hear from these that you can smell from the high power rifle. It was so serious that they even had their weapons drawn. Now, there was also somebody under the Truman balcony who could see the debris falling from the shots on the ground, okay? With all that, they're calling this out over the radio. They're not his listening. Shots fired. There was a guy who was a habitual white supremacist official. He said, no shots fired, stand down. Now, this is the White House. The president, you know, Barack Obama, he does live here. The president does live here. This is supposed to be a terrorist attack, you know? It's a terrorist attack. So they called it out over again numerous times. The same official said, no shots fired, stand down. Now, after this happened, nobody told the first family about this. What happened was there was an usher who seen glass on the floor. He seen glass on the floor, and he told Michelle Obama. She didn't know anything about it. So after he told Michelle Obama, you know, she made her contacts and, you know, called who she had to call and said, hey, what's going on? And that's how they found out. Now, the official who was saying, no shots fired, stand down, he should have been fired immediately. For that right there, you should be fired. He wasn't fired. But he also stuck around to be part of another tragedy that's in the book. But that can be referenced too. If you ever look at what's the guy named Trey Gowdy? Who's the guy? He used to get into the Secret Service real heavy at Capitol Hill. Trey Gowdy is his name. If you ever Google, or you can go to YouTube, just look at Trey Gowdy gets in the Secret Service. He goes over this actual event right here, and he grills the hell out of the agency, the director, everybody, and he just has them sitting there looking stupid because it makes no sense. But the things that I cover in the book is they don't get into the culture of systemic racism in the agency, which is how guys like that could be part of something like that and could be neglect their duties and still have, you know, enjoy their careers. And that was my whole thing. So these things right like that, they're already out in the media, they're in the news. But my thing is people don't know that the guys who drop the ball on these incidents are these white supremacist officials and guys around here, and they never get in trouble. That guy should be, for you should be, that's a terrorist day. You should be fired for that. He wasn't.
Concealing of information, that would be another great illustration right there. Willful concealing of information. Was that it, Thomas, in New York?
Yeah, just the last little part. I believe you said that the person who thwarted this attempt was a black person and they weren't commendated for their
action. That's a whole different attack. Okay, so another one, there was a guy who wanted another guy who wanted to kill President Obama, and he was at the White House previously claiming to be Jesus. I think it was maybe a week prior he was claiming to be Jesus. So he came back, and he had a machete that day. So he came back, jumped the fence, got all the way into the White House. I mean, physically in the White House, and went past everybody. Even you could even see a video where he walked past a Caucasian officer who was there, walked right past him. He was eventually subdued. There were two African-American officers who tried to subdue him. One of them was a female and the other guy, and you know, this is a grown man. She did what she could, but he was eventually subdued by an African-American officer. And you know, he didn't receive anything for this, you know, and some of the things that we've seen these guys receiving valor awards for and different things, different accolades, for pretty much doing nothing, you know. But that's just how they treated us in that agency. I mean, it was horrible. And it still is. So that was another attempt. There was one, the one on Constitution Avenue, and there was the other one, which came from Pennsylvania Avenue with this guy. He also had a knife, so he wanted to go to work. Luckily, the president wasn't, you know, he wasn't home at the time.
Much obliged, Thomas. Thank you. In New York, retired firefighter. Did you have a question for Mr. Abdul-Raheem?
Greetings, everyone.
Greetings.
Yes, sir. To the guests, you stated earlier in the interview that had you... I think you said 2019, had you had to do things over again with the incident that took place on one of your jobs, that you would ask for an apology. Is that correct?
I would have done things different. I would have asked for an apology. I would have definitely did things different with my black coworkers, though. We would have had to, we would have had to have a meeting about this, and we'd have to have a discussion. And yes, I would have definitely asked for an agency-wide apology. I mean, something, mass email, something. Not that it would matter then.
My question would be to you, you're kind of like, I guess, answering it. But what would be your expectations on getting an apology? What would be your expectations?
None. I just would have had to wanted to feel like I did something, you know what I mean? Because that's how I really felt anyway. You know what I mean? But I just would have wanted to feel like something, you know? But would it have done anything? Absolutely not. I'm not even really a fan of these public, these apologies. But in that situation, I know the apology wouldn't have had any effect. It wouldn't have meant anything because this is what's in their hearts anyway, was in his heart.
I just would have wanted to feel like, okay, yeah, say something. You know what I mean? Just, I guess it would have been a personal thing, but it would have meant anything, though. No. Okay. I understand what you mean, definitely.
Yes, sir. Okay. The job that's called Secret Services, I guess most best well known for the people who, quote unquote, protect the president. But what are some of the other activities or job positions that the Secret Service handles?
The Secret Service handles counterfeit money investigations, protection for the president, protection for foreign dignitaries when they come from other countries. And that's pretty much it. Within the agency, it's just agency-wide intelligence, which protection of the president is the main goal. Besides protecting for the president and the other entities that do that play a role in that, you know, some guys you see are, you know, police officers, some guys are directly right next to the president, some guys are snipers, some guys are, you know, as many different positions. But in addition to the protection for the president, his family, and former presidents and foreign dignitaries from other countries, you have counterfeit money investigation. And I didn't know that until the day that I discussed in the book, until I had my first interview, when I seen a guy in the office telling on somebody in Trenton. I was like, huh, what's he telling on? They were asking him about counterfeit money. And then after that, eventually, with time and age, after starting the job and doing more research, I knew that the agency was responsible for counterfeit money investigation.
Two part question. First part, are you still employed with the Secret Service?
No, I'm not. No, I'm not.
Okay. I'm just thinking that in the nature of your job, that if being that you were in a job that had, you know, very high security or something that you couldn't divulge to another person, other than, I guess, another Secret Service agent. does this profession still have something like a lifetime track on its former employees, or is there some sort of restrictions that are imposed upon you for being in a job like that?
Well, you know, I really don't know. I'm pretty sure, and they listening to this right now, or, you know, reading a book, you know, stuff like that. But as you can see, I don't know if you have the book. If not, I hope you purchase it. But I don't speak of anything confidential in the book as far as security is concerned, things that I might have seen, things that I might know as far as security is concerned. Everything that I discuss in the book is already in the media. It can be through the congressional oversight, U.S. Secret Service congressional oversight, through YouTube, through Google, many different articles, Washington Post and other media outlets. So I don't get into discussing anything about any protectees, personal information, or anything security-wise. Now, there are guys who have wrote from the Secret Service that have, you know, wrote books about things like this, but that's not my lane. That's not something that I get into. My whole thing was to discuss my experience with the culture of systemic racism and white supremacy in the agency, so that other people, you know, can know that we can relate, and for, you know, the youth who might want to embark on these careers to know what they're getting into. But as far as confidential information and stuff like that, that shouldn't be said, I don't discuss any of that. But there are guys who have, I mean, in their books. I don't know, you know, how that goes.
I think your book would be very helpful to a non-white person who would want to be employed. Last question. Have you met the non-white black male who was the first employee of the Secret Service, and if you have met him, could you recall the conversation and or interaction?
No, I haven't met him. But it depends on which one we're speaking about. Are we talking about Abraham Bolden?
There was one. I think he was actually fired from the job.
from my understanding.
Okay.
I could be wrong.
We might be speaking about Abraham Bolden, and he does interviews as well. I've never met him, but I read a lot of his stuff, and I also listened to quite a few of his interviews, but I've never met him. But he has a real interesting story, really deep. We're talking about Abraham Bolden, I believe.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate you coming on the program. And yes, you can fit right into workplace racism on the days that we have it, based on what I'm hearing. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for calling in, sir.
Much obliged. The caller, last four digits, 1553. 1553. Did you have a question for Mr. Abdul-Raheem?
Hey, Gus, can you come back to me? I'm in a noisy environment.
Yes, sir. Imhan DC, he was with us in Virginia, Cal's yoga retreat just last month. Did you have a question, Imhan DC? You should be with us, sir.
Yes, sir. Greetings. And greetings to you. Yes, sir. I had a question. So my question is, if all white people are indeed white supremacists, should our actions be different to end white supremacy? So there's two options: either all white people are white supremacists, or some white people are white supremacists. Would our actions be different? If all white people are white supremacists, would our actions be different to end white supremacy?
Is that one for, is that me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm not sure exactly how you would answer it, but yes, sir, that's my question.
Okay. So your question is, if are all white people white supremacists, and if they are, should the way we react to them be different?
To end white supremacy, because I would imagine our goal is to end white supremacy. Yes, sir. Should our response be different?
Okay, so all white people, white supremacists. All white people benefit from white supremacy. So I think that would be, you know, the main thing. So white supremacy, of course, is coming from me. With white supremacy, we can't pick and choose the white people who we don't think are white supremacists. They pretty much all benefit from this system, you know, of white supremacy. So therefore, if they're beneficiaries of white supremacy, I mean, there you go. They have to play a role in this. Now you ask me, can you ask the second part again? As far as, I think it's something to do with as far as how I feel we should deal with them.
Well, yes, sir. Should we behave differently if all white people are white supremacists to end white supremacy? If I'm making sense, should we behave differently if they are all white supremacists as opposed to not being all white supremacists?
Well, I believe we should behave differently. Yeah. In a nutshell. Whether they all are, or, you know, whether somebody thinks they all are, or if they all aren't, or if some of them are and some of them aren't. Yeah, I believe that we should definitely behave differently. But I'm trying to understand what, as far as behaving differently, I'm trying to understand what that means. Like, in, you know, it's kind of
yes, sir. My question may not have been posed exactly the way I wanted. Post, but well, basically, I can ask this question then. In your opinion, what should we do to end white supremacy in the shortest time frame possible?
We can't. I don't think that the ending white supremacy is something that we can do in a short time frame. Or, to be honest with you, I don't think that ending white supremacy is something. Supremacy is something that we're going to be able to end on our own. You know, I can take this to a whole nother level. I think there are some things that we need to do as people to stay on code and to
make sure that certain things don't happen to us. Of course, I don't have the lay down and quit mentality, but as far as us white supremacy, I don't think that we can end white supremacy. So.
Yes,
not by ourselves. I believe we have to be an act of God to end white supremacy as well.
I totally understand that. I had another question.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. So, defense.
Right.
What advice would you give black people
mm-hmm.
in order to defend themselves? Armed defense, unarmed defense. Is there any advice that you would give the masses
Definitely.
Of black people?
Definitely. The first thing I would say to our black people is to do what you have to do to get yourself in shape. Try to improve your diet, your health and well-being. I believe that we all should be able to handle ourselves in a situation. If a situation went to, physical, or if we had to, run away, jump, scrap, we should be able to breathe. I feel like as black people, number one, we should improve our diets, improve our health, and also try to improve our physical well-being by doing things such as exercise and, anything that's going to, taking learning a martial art but my main thing is something like martial arts might be kind of far for a lot of people, but I feel like that we all should be in a state where we can handle ourselves physically, meaning being able to run without passing out, being able to jump without, being able to get away if we need to, physically able. For starters, just, improve our health, because I feel that being unhealthy and not being able to handle yourself physically, just yourself, just your own body, like, without anything exterior doing anything to you, that's a pretty bad state to be in if you can't run. And I see so many of our people to where if we had to run 100 yards, we'd be done, And this is all due to our, our diet and our lack of exercise and, poor health hygiene. So I would say that for our people, we should, work on trying to improve our health hygiene for a lot of reasons.
Yes, sir. I appreciate it.
That guy mentioned in the context of self-defense. Wow. And I mentioned again the CAL's 2019 10-year anniversary yoga retreat, plant-based meals, yoga 2 times a day. He mentioned diet and exercise in the context
Definitely.
Of self-defense. Mm.
Definitely. It's a very dangerous state for our people to be in when, we can't even jog. We can't even, so many of us can't run, or do certain things without passing out. So for starters, we definitely need to improve our health, because it's a very dangerous state to be in. Very dangerous state to be in. When you're unhealthy and you have such a lot of physical restrictions, you can't, pretty much get up. You can't help your family. You can't help yourself. So we should definitely work on trying to improve our health for starters. And that improves self-defense also.
Mm. Logic. Caller, are you in a spot, I guess, where you can get your question in? 1553. You able to speak with us now?
Yes. Speaking on physical fitness, I'm in the gym right now. That's why the environment is noisy. Yeah, so I agree. It's a couple of things I wanted to ask, but I just keep it to one question. Gus, Gus always stresses, and also if you're familiar with Millie Fuller, shadow boxing, and also going back and forth with other victims of white supremacy. So what was your code on the workplace with dealing with other black victims, black people, that would kind of act against the interests of other black employees? Did you see that a lot on the workplace? And if you did, how did you interact with those other black officers, agents?
Okay, so I'm just trying to answer the question correctly. So, one more time, please. I'm sorry.
Okay. Other black agents that may have not believed that racism was a problem on the force,
mm-hmm.
and they may have acted in ways that worked against other black agents' mm-hmm. self-interest or safety. Without name calling, you know, nowadays people may refer to them as sellouts and, you know, mm-hmm. other derogatory terms for blacks who work against black self-interest on the workplace. How do you interact with agents that behave in that manner? Or have you ever seen that kind of behavior in the agency?
Yeah, that was a major obstacle for me. That was a major obstacle for me. I just call them, for the show, mentally compromised black people.
For this context, I'm sorry for interrupting, Mr. Abdul-Raheem. I was cracking up laughing the whole time because I have read his book, and I was like, uh-oh, let's see how he's going to I think it would be important because we are about being truthful on the program, so let's maybe rewind and let's give a truthful answer, because we are about being truthful. So let's give a truthful. I did give him a disclaimer about no name calling, right? So I think he is trying to respect the platform. So much obliged, much respect. Thank you so much. But let's go ahead and get a truthful answer to his question, sir.
Okay. So to answer that question, that was a major obstacle for me in my career. So I was caught between, you know, my people and my people who were pretty much, you know, just sellouts, you know. So what often happened is I would have mixed emotions. So there were, like you just, like you asked, there were quite a few guys who didn't think that the atmosphere was as bad or as racist as it was. Sometimes some of these guys were clearly, you know, mentally compromised, and some of them were just, you know, doing what they call playing the game in order to they say playing the game to get ahead or whatever. That was a rough one because man, that was a real rough one. Got me thinking about it. So it was hard for me to even, you know, interact with some of my own people, because so many of these guys were, they didn't, quite a few of them. There are some stand up black men and women that I've met in the U.S. Secret Service. But most of them that I've met were only stand up around other black people. And when they got around, you know, these white people, their white daddies or whoever, they always turned into popcorn shrimp. And it was really hard because if something is going on and you have this way that you're going to deal with a particular person or a particular incident, and you go about it the right way, in the way that you're supposed to go about it. And I'm not talking about, you know, swinging on people and busting heads and nothing like that. Let's just say addressing it or sending an email or contacting the EEO counselor. This was often looked at as radical behavior because we were often judged not as individuals, but as groups of people. So if there's a person, another, you know, black person that came before me, and he did the whole buck dance and the whole dog and pony show for these people, once I come behind him and I don't do that, I'm a rebel. I'm a bad employee. I'm not a team player. This is pretty much what happened. This is what happens in these type of workplaces, these type of work environments. Dealing with people who didn't think things were as bad as they were, I stayed away from them, man. I didn't want to have conflict with my own people, so I pretty much would speak to them, you know, give them their respect. Hey, how you doing? What's up? And I would keep them moving. I tried not to get too involved,
and being buddy, but I didn't attend the events with him. I made sure that I didn't go, you know, participate in certain events with my own people. I didn't like the fact that we couldn't do anything to make progress or combat some of the white supremacy and racism at work. And I felt that if we wasn't going to do that, it was no reason for me to sit around, you know, after hours and do anything, whether it be a get together, a party or anything. You know, my thing was, I kind of stayed away. I didn't want to have conflict with my people, but I just couldn't get down with them outside of work for those reasons right there. And that's how I dealt with them. I tried to keep it respectful, but I had to stay away outside of work. Because to me, that's just fake to me. It's fake. My thing was, our people are in here getting dog walked by these white supremacists every day. And outside of work, all we could do was sit back and laugh, have sports talk, and eat wings and carry on and giggle and talk about what they're doing, but we're not going to do nothing about it. I just couldn't get with it. So my thing was just to stay away outside. You know, I didn't participate in, you know, the extracurricular activities that black people had outside of work, black coworkers, and some of them I liked. You know, most of them I would say I probably liked. I mean, there were a few that I disliked, but most of our people I liked, but I couldn't. It wasn't something that I was going to do. I couldn't participate in, you know, and be involved in these things because it was just such a battle for me. It was a rough battle, you know, to know that, you know, it's almost like, how could you be so scared of these people? You know, how could you be so scared? Like, we're not going to do anything. This person did this. We're not going to do nothing about it. And I just wasn't wired like that. I just couldn't do it, you know. So my thing was just to stay away. It was rough. That was one of the roughest parts because I expected different, you know, at least a little different. I just didn't know that. I didn't know that men were that scared. It was shocking to me. And it was a new experience for me to see men who were that scared. I don't know, man. I just didn't get it.
Yeah. You know, and Gus, I just wanted to follow up and then I'm done. I just asked that question because, you know, I work in New York City and I also work around Trump Tower. So I see not too many black Secret Service agents, but I watch how they congregate. So I see a lot of black Secret Service agents off on their own and other white Secret Service or grouped together like they hang amongst each other. And I see that distance. I see that standoffishness. So I would assume that probably was maybe you on a Secret Service where you just kind of did your own thing. And,
definitely.
You know, and
that's what I know.
And also, right, because I see it when I'm in the city and
sir?
I ride by Trump Tower. Oh, no, that's all, and I'm done.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Much obliged.
All
sir.
Right, thanks a lot, bro.
Much obliged.
No problem.
Let's see. If you had a question, don't lollygag, *61. If you have a question for Mr. Abdul-Raheem, who does use the word coon in the book liberally and sell out.
Yeah, man. I was holding off. I was trying to respect the disclaimer. You know, hey, check this out. I even wrote mentally compromised down a piece of paper. Right in front of me. I'm dead scared. I can't make this up. I said, man, I can't use my words. let me respect the show. So I literally have it wrote down on a piece of paper, mentally compromised, just to remind myself not to use coon or sellout or, you know, bellhop. You know.
Context of white
Gus,
supremacy.
You know what? I had one more question. It just dawned on me.
Yeah, yes, sir.
I picked up on your name. Did you have any incidents of them purposely mispronouncing your name, and if they did, how did you handle that?
No, I didn't have them. I didn't have any instance of mispronouncing my name because my name is long, but it's pretty easy to pronounce. You know, it's pretty common. But if they, it wasn't common for that agency, of course. I mean, that my name stuck out like a sore thumb, and I knew that, and it's the first one on the list in the whole agency. You know, because of the AB. D, you know, you got the first letter, the second letter, and my last name, and then the fourth letter in the alphabet, you know. But I knew that my name stuck out like a sore thumb. As far as pronouncing it wrong,
No, because most of the time I was just called by my last name. Some people just called me by my first name. So I didn't have issues with people pronouncing my name wrong, but I knew that my name stuck out like a sore thumb. And as far as issues with my name, of course, I mean, there were issues. I mean, I know that I was probably the most researched person or looked up person in the agency. When they seen that name, they had to type my name in and say, like, let me see what this is. Look at this name. Let me see who this guy is. But I didn't have a lot of issues straight to my face, you know, with a lot of these guys, because I kind of give off a lot of people knew I wasn't really playing, you know? So I kept to myself. I kept my mouth shut, and, you know, I didn't walk around with my shoulders all sucked in and everything and looking, you know, looking scared and weak. So, of course, a lot of these guys are cowards, by the way. We all know this, and this is law enforcement. A lot of these guys are cowards, but, so I'm pretty sure there were a lot of things done, you know, behind closed doors or behind my back. But to my face, I probably only had one issue with a guy, you know, straight to my face, where I had to say some stuff to him. Kind of wild. But that was about it.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for calling, brother.
Much obliged, sir. Miriam Carey, but before I get to Miriam Carey, you do talk about, as I said, coon is used liberally in the book. You do talk about one black coworker that you had a lot of difficulty with, or not difficulty, but a black, I guess, would be representative of this Jubilee Alexander black male who would do, I guess, a lot of smiling and the exact opposite of what you would do, smiling and joking with white people and engaging in all of their racist stereotypes about black people and that. So, yeah, Soul Plane is on. Woohoo. Let's watch it. I'm going to do all the jokes right along. Definitely. This is the best thing ever. Woohoo. Let's get wings and have a good time. Let's watch the sequel, too. This is where the counter racist logic for me kicks in, that I ask, and I would put this to listeners too, at the United States Secret Service, what was Jubilee Alexander in charge of?
Well, Jubilee Alexander is in charge. It's just, of course, you know, I had to protect identities. So, you know, I have to switch names around, but this guy, was pretty much, somebody from the top all the way to the bottom, a representative of a certain type of black man.
Oh, but wait a minute. The question was, what was he in charge of? Or if he's still working, what is he in charge of?
What is he in charge of?
Yes, sir. In terms of the United States Secret Service.
He's just an officer in the Secret Service.
So
he's not particularly in charge of, you know, it, as far as a title or, He's not somebody who's a high-ranking guy.
No. Okay. That right there, in terms of counter-racist logic, the same counter-racist logic that you used in saying, you know what, I'm not going to give these guys any advance notice that the Secret Service folks are coming to talk to them. That's the same logic that I use that, you know what, regardless of how many stories that he tells about the white women that he slept with at the strip club, no matter how many jokes that he tells to these white people, no matter what he does, if he actually literally comes in and breaks out breakdancing, literally, on the floor, he is not in charge of anything. I do not need to pay attention to him at all. I wouldn't care if he came in and did breakdancing with fried chicken in MC Hammer pants every day. And then he changed it up, came in the next week and said, I'm going to do Drake this week every day with fried chicken and watermelon every day. He's not in charge of anything. So all of the, I ask victims of racism that, I think that is, you know, something we need to examine. Like, our time and energy cannot be focused on people who really don't have any power in the system of racism, white supremacy. If Jubilee Alexander, irritating though he may be, if he's not really in charge of anything, then, you know, let's get back to the racist instructor over here who is, you know, making it disqualifying folks left and right. Like, that is someone that, yeah, we're going to need to neutralize. Like, this could be the end of our career right here with it. But anyway, Miriam Carey. We have talked about Miriam Carey 2013. not enough. Black journalists have failed. That's what some folks who have called in to the COWS have recorded, reported that black journalists have failed. I think that's what Eric Saunders said when I spoke with him on the phone, that black journalists have failed. That's the attorney for Miss Miss Carey and her family, that they have failed and not getting enough attention. You talk about him in the book and having met him personally and talked to him about her case. She was reported, again, words, it was reported that she rammed a barrier at the White House. You know, this was when we had that Negro Obama in the White House and we had all those death threats. It was tough times not that long ago. And so we just can't have people ramming barriers. That's what they said. We can't have random Negros ramming barriers at the White House. So, of course, you know, she had to be shot. And isn't that the protocol at the Secret Service? Isn't that what's supposed to happen?
No. Well, the whole story, what was put out initially was a lie. You know, that didn't happen. That didn't happen at all. Miriam Carey didn't ram barriers at the White House like some of the first stories that came out of the report. Although I have seen this happen. I have seen white people ram barriers at the White House and, you know, get wrestled to the ground. But that's, you know, a whole other thing. I discussed that in the book. But no, Miriam Carey didn't ram barriers at the White House. Miriam Carey drove in to a unsecured area at the White House, coming off of 15th Street. She drove into an unsecured area, which means this is an area that anybody could walk into or drive into. It's not a secured area. It's considered a dirty area, meaning that anybody who, any vehicle or person who went inside that area were not secured or cleaned and swept or inspected to make sure they didn't have any explosives or things of that such, things of that nature. So all Miriam Carey did was drove into a unsecured area. And what she did was when she drove in, she went past a post that are manned by U.S. Secret Service officers. Now, she rode right past them. And when she rode in, what she did when she drove in, what she did was she turned around and made a U-turn and she was making her way out. As she was driving out, these officers that she went past, of course, they were going up to the car trying to see who it was. Like, hey, roll your window down. Who are you? She didn't roll the window around and stop and speak to them. Of course, she wasn't speeding because they wouldn't have been trying to go up to the car, you know, in the first place. So basically what Miriam Carey did is what they would have told her to do anyway. She didn't break the law. She would have broken the law if she didn't leave the area, but she was leaving. The only thing that she did that was kind of odd, but she still wasn't illegal, was she didn't roll the window down and speak to these guys. And these guys were only going to tell her, hey, just leave. They would have looked in the car and said, hey, just, you know, just make this U-turn and leave. She was already doing that. So the problem came in is when she was doing that, as these guys were yelling, you know, saying, hey, trying to get her attention, there was a guy walking home who happened to be a U.S. Secret Service officer. He's off duty. So he looks like a regular guy walking down the street. And what happened was he took a bike rack and tried to put it in front of her car as she was exiting onto 15th Street. As she was exiting on the 15th Street, he took a bike rack and tried to put it in front of her car. He wasn't successful. So what he did is grab the bike rack again, and this time he put it in front of her car, but he put his body in the way. And she bumped the bike rack. He tumbled down and kept she kept on going onto 15th Street. There were witnesses there who said that she wasn't speeding. And then if this officer, if she was speeding and driving like, you know, like a crazy woman, this officer wouldn't have had two attempts to put this bike rack in front of her car. He tried it once. He wasn't successful. Then he tried it again. Now, being that this happened and he was on the ground, it looks like, oh, one of our guys are down. She hit him or whatever, you know, she ran him over and knocked him over. So after that, this goes over the air. So now, boom, the Cowboys are in pursuit. So they hear it over the air and they're out rushing, you know, trying to catch her. You know, she's driving towards the Capitol. They're, you know, sirens going, flaring. They're going, you know, trying to get there. Basically trying to get there. One of the
one of the guys who was in pursuit of her went over the air and voiced how fast he was going. When he did that, his official, who was there also, changed the rate of speed that he was going. Okay? So it didn't look like they were on a high-speed chase or they were chasing somebody because they weren't supposed to be doing that in the first place. So he changed the rate of speed. What's crazy is this same guy is the one who said no shots fired. He should have been fired anyway, right? He should have been gone after the incident when a guy shot on Constitution Avenue at the White House. And he's the official who said no shots fired. He's the same one who's in the congressional report and the one that they speak about in the news, this guy. He's involved in this Miriam Carey thing, changing the rate of speed now. Okay? So, they're on the way to the Capitol, and when they go to the Capitol, these guys are, running up to her car, trying to get her attention. Now, she's still not speeding because these guys wouldn't have thought they could run up to the car and, you know, knock on the window and bang on the window with their guns drawn. There's also people who said that, you know, there was a threat of somebody being in the vehicle with a high power rifle and also somebody, she could have explosives in the car. Now, if these officers and these people who are approaching the car thought that, they wouldn't have been running up to the car. Nobody in their right mind is going to run up to a car where they think that somebody might be in the back with an AK-47 or the car might be rigged with bombs and it's going to explode. Like, nobody would do that in their right mind. You're going to stay as far away as possible. Nobody's going to keep running up to a car, banging on a window, saying, hey, get out, what you doing, and yelling if they think that there is a possibility of somebody in the back seat spraying them with a high-powered rifle or the car exploding. Nobody's going to do that. They clearly didn't think. They weren't in danger. You know, they didn't feel like they were in danger. So when if one watches the video, she pulls off, and then the guy started firing rounds at her. And that's when, you know, they killed her. There were Capitol Police officers who were there at the time, who worked for Capitol Police, who also sent the attorney for the family, Eric Sanders, on Capitol Police letterheads. They sent him information explaining to him why what happened up there was wrong. It was, you know, it was illegal and it shouldn't have happened. So here you have people on one side explaining one thing at the Capitol Hill. Then you have people on the other side who know what's going on in the Secret Service, which at least the Capitol Hill officers, you know, had the heart to at least send something anonymously, which makes sense because, you know, if they didn't, their jobs would definitely be in jeopardy. But at least they did something. And when I spoke to Eric Sanders, you know, I explained to him some of the protocol and how things what should have happened, what did happen, and what wasn't supposed to happen. And there was also another officer who spoke to Eric Sanders even before I did, which I didn't know. And I commend him for that also. And that's what happened.
When this event took place 2013, mm-hmm. Did you get a sense like, oh man, this is exactly what was supposed to happen? Like, when you were hearing people, your colleagues and what have you, talking about this event at the time, was it a sense of, yeah, this is agency protocol, this is what we were supposed to do?
Yeah, definitely. So this is how, you know, the officials who spoke about this, this is how they sounded. This was the way they carried the conversation. It was pretty bad because I remember one official, he stood up in roll call and he said, we haven't had a kill like this in some years, or we haven't had a kill. The exact word was kill, like it was, you know, Viet Cong or something like that. You know, his exact words are, we haven't had a kill. And it was basically, watch what you're saying out there, you know, because the media is everywhere. But the way he said that, we didn't have, it was almost like, you know, he said like she was a deer or something. They continued to give us reassurance that it was a good shoot. But, you know, some of us knew that it wasn't. I had a couple use of force debates with a couple people. Some of them agreed with me, and others were, you know, falling for the okey-doke, the story in which was put out there in the media. Because of the officer at the White House who was knocked over, basically their argument was, you don't have to wait for somebody to do something before you use deadly force if they already showed that they would do it. But that's not what happened, you know? So basically, in order to use deadly force, if you go and shoot seven people and you run away, I don't have to wait for you to shoot somebody else before I shoot you, because you already showed me that you would shoot people. So they tried to use that same scenario with the vehicle. She already showed that she's going to knock people over and run them over with her car, which she didn't, you know. Like I said, the guy jumped in front of a car twice, because nobody in their right mind is going to jump in front of a speeding car. They're trying to go home. I mean, this guy was on his way home. So what they were trying to say is, she already showed that she would do that there. Therefore, they don't have to wait for her to do it again up here so they can use deadly force, which that's not true, because that's not what happened.
Her one-year-old child in the backseat of the vehicle, as well, visible in the backseat of the vehicle, in my opinion, if folks are coming up and knocking on the window, and these are not just civilians, these are trained enforcement officials, I would think they would be looking to see, oh man, do we have another terrorist? Is Bin Laden in the backseat? Oh, okay, it's just a one-year-old. I mean, I would think they would be looking for that sort of thing, but apparently that did not dissuade.
Go ahead.
And that went over the air also. Oh. They knew that went over the air, and there was a baby in the car.
That's what I would think. You got folks who are trained in surveillance. They would see that sort of thing, of course. But that, hey, we got to kill. We got to kill. That's that's what I would expect in the system of racism, white supremacy, not ignorant about racism at all. We are not doing our full 3 hours. Not going to keep Mr. Abdul-Raheem the entire evening. Were there any changes to policy and procedure after this event? Did they come back and say, oh man, we need to make some adjustments here? We learned a few things. Did that happen?
Not that I could remember at all. Not that I remember. I don't remember anything changing. It was pretty much like these guys did their job and that was it. When what was crazy is two of the role players in this shouldn't have even been on the job. Well, they shouldn't have been out there. One was previously removed for, you know, his mental instability, traumatic, due to some traumatic issues that he was having after witnessing a woman get hit by a car, being the first responder to that. And he was actually taken out of that position. And it just so happened he's back out there not too long after that, after his superiors knew that he was shaken up, he was traumatized by what he's seen. He's back out there now, you know, killing somebody.
Context of white supremacy. I cannot say I am surprised. This is not a system about promoting health and wellness at all in any respect. The book we have been discussing, The N-Word Is No Secret in the Service. The author, Muhammad Abdul-Raheem, did an outstanding job of not employing the term coon. What is it? Mentally compromised individual? Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, that's the word. That's what I wrote down on my sheet of paper right here. I was trying to honor the code. No.
For listeners, because we have listeners who have struggled with the word coon, now you have a substitute, mentally compromised individual. Dr. Welsing would absolutely appreciate no name calling. We're all struggling and trying to do the best that we can. We've all been victimized, system of racism, white supremacy. But I'm so thankful that you were able to share a bit of your Tuesday evening to come speak with us, promote your book, and discuss workplace racism, really. But so thankful that you were able to come and share some time with us. I hope folks will.
Thanks for having me. One more question.
Let's see. We have 30 seconds.
I remember the white man flying a gyrocopter with a bunch of letters to the White House lawn, and the FAA even clearing space for him to fly through. How come that man wasn't taken down in the same respect as Ms. Carey? And he was actually on the lawn.
Well, because he was white. It's quite a few incidents, man. Quite a few things went down where
if the Marion Carey deadly force was justifiable, I mean, I know of quite a few other incidents where deadly force, you know, should have been used. Not saying that it should have, you know, but we definitely know that this Marion Carey incident, it shouldn't have been a deadly force situation. But, you know, people pick and choose. I guess it's just like the incident that just happened in Oregon, I believe, the other day. This dude ran up to the cop and stabbed him. They didn't even shoot him. Was that in Oregon?
I'm not sure if it was in Oregon, but I know there are a number of incidents where whites have been able to get very close to enforcement officers with, you know, knives, other weapons, firearms even sometimes, and they are not treated in the same way that mother of a one-year-old, Miriam I. Carey, was treated at our nation's capital. We will wrap there. Much obliged, Thomas in New York, for your question, and much obliged again to the author of The N-Word is No Secret in the Service, Muhammad Abdul-Raheem. Much obliged for sharing your time and energy with us this evening. Hopefully we will have you back on the broadcast, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot for having me.
It has been a pleasure. Hopefully listeners got something constructive out of the dialogue. You have another book that you can get, Dr. Welsing. Again, reading is more important than watching television. Certainly, if it's Soul Plane is the option, man, get anything. Any book would be better than Soul Plane. With that, going to do my yoga, self-care as self-defense, exercise, eating correctly as self-defense. Love it. Hopefully we can make that a theme at the California Yoga Retreat. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. You already heard the explanation and reason why. I don't have to repeat it. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up each and every time we are in a vehicle, passenger or driver. Let's do all that we can to minimize contact with race soldiers, badge or no. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other Black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of Black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another Black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
A victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.